Maurice Cheeks likes what he sees. In game three, he scored 7 straight points in another crucial fourth quarter to lead Philadelphia to victory. The Bucks looked beaten, and their fans were realistic.
Unfortunately, Milwaukee and Philadelphia have to play each other off before you can get to the big game. And it's happened before, and it continues happening. It's just a shame you got to play Philadelphia every time to get into the last game.
In game four, the Bucks were playing for pride. They refused to go down easy. Again, the game was close all the way, but this time, with balanced scoring and some clutch play off the bench, they held off the Sixers' charge. The Bucks won it in the last quarter, but they were still deep in the hole.
You think back to the number of teams that have been down 3-0 and have come back to win. Does it bother you?
Have there been any?
No.
Oh, okay.
Heading back to Philadelphia, the Bucks knew they had to buckle down to business. Their season was riding on these games, and they had traveled too far to come up empty. They knew they had to go all out.
And no better time than tonight, because it's sudden death for Milwaukee the rest of the way as the 76ers look to wrap it up in game five from the Spectrum.
Confidence was flowing outside as well.
Little Mo, Big Mo, the doctor, Andrew Toney, and Iavaroni. No baloney. Sixers all the way.
Philly fans wanted to put an end to the Bucks' one-game win streak. And the Sixers set out early to shut down the Bucks' offense and run away with the game. The entire team hit its stride, played their best game of the series with outside shooting, inside muscle, and some sweet movement. Philly loved its heroes. Moses put in a full night's work, and the Sixers had this one in the bag with time to spare. Julius Erving led the way, Bobby Jones played his solid D, and the whole Sixers squad contributed. The fans could see their stars were shining brightly. When Moses had joined the team at the start of the season, there'd been some question about team harmony. Now they had blended perfectly and were going to the NBA Finals.
It was just our best performance that we've had so far in the playoffs. And it leaves me with a good taste in my mouth because of the way we played.
Whenever they had to do something on the court, they did it efficiently. They met every challenge that we gave them.
They're the next world champions as far as I'm concerned, without any question. This is the best team that I've seen in 10 years.
Obviously you're disappointed, but you just got your butt kicked. That's about it.
In his 13-year career, Bob Lanier has never had the chance to shine in the spotlight of an NBA final. He'd trade almost anything for one title shot.
Because when all is said and done, they'll say that he never got that ring.
I did my best, but I guess my best wasn't good enough. 'Cause here we are back where we were before. Seems nothing ever changes. We're back to being strangers, wondering if we ought to stay or head on out the door. Just once, can we figure out what we keep doing wrong? Why we never last for very long? What are we doing wrong? Just once, can we find a way to finally make it right? To make the magic last for more than just one night. We could just get to it. I know we could break through it.
Bob Lanier isn't the only man to live with this frustration. In the history of the NBA, there have been many extraordinary ball players. Men like Dave Bing, who played with grace and heart, but never went all the way.
Just once, can we find a way to finally make it right? Whoa,
Out west, the San Antonio Spurs were in line for a title shot. George Gervin was another man who had only come close.
30 years old, I've been playing 10 years, and I won a lot of scoring titles, and I have gained a lot of respect, and a lot of people admire me from winning that scoring title. But what's real to me is that's winning a championship.
The Spurs fans aren't shy about making a ruckus, and George Gervin isn't shy about putting up his shots. In game one against the Denver Nuggets, Gervin scored 42. It was a run-and-gun bonanza, a real fan's delight. As Spurs coach Stan Albeck directed traffic, the game set a playoff record for total points scored as the West went wild and the ball kept falling. San Antonio bounced out on top of the series 152-143. Denver coach Doug Moe had seen enough of Gervin. They have their own style in Texas, and Moe made a tactical decision for the rest of the series to shut down Gervin and make guard Johnny Moore beat the Nuggets. Moore was up to the task.
He was out in the street. He did not even have a job 3 years ago, came to training camp and earned it, and now is starting to receive the recognition that he rightfully deserves.
For the next four games, Moore went wild, scoring 39 points one night, dishing off a playoff record of 20 assists another, and taking a firm hand in leading the Spurs to victory. Coach Moe's best words were lost, as the Spurs had the series in their grasp and powered their way into the conference finals. In the other Western semifinal, the upstart Portland Trail Blazers lost the first two games to the defending champion Los Angeles Lakers. Lakers coach Pat Riley had some heavy guns to go to, but his squad was not at full strength. Number one draft choice James Worthy had broken his leg in a late season accident, and veteran front court man Bob McAdoo was also out of action.
That's just the breaks of the game. We have injuries, and, you know, we're trying to play with them.
Me and James Worthy were really important. You know, when you miss 30 points, it's going to hurt you.
The burden fell on Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and the Laker captain responded magnificently in the first two games. Kareem was no favorite at the Portland Memorial Coliseum. Blazer fans were hungry. But coach Jack Ramsey knew his team was not as gifted as the Lakers, and if the Blazers were going to win, he would have to come up with an inspired game plan. Ramsey was respected as perhaps the league's best coach, and he was going to have to win with the smarts and strength. The book on Kareem is that you have to muscle him, and the Trailblazers went after him at every opportunity. Coach Ramsey approved, and the plan was working, as the Blazers, led by all-star guard Jim Paxson, would not give up and push the game into overtime. But when Coach Riley wanted the big play, he looked to the big guy. With game three on the line and time running down, Abdul-Jabbar stormed out and put up his famous skyhook. That was it for the Blazers. The Lakers took the series in five, and Abdul-Jabbar showed again that he is at the top of his game. In his 14-year NBA career, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar has been voted Most Valuable Player a record six times and has played on three championship teams. Even as he grows older, the playoffs are his time.
Guys aren't supposed to be playing the way he's playing when you're 36. And, you know, he's constantly criticized and harangued during the regular season and during the